One evening, I was traveling home by car on my regular route from work. By the time I left at midnight, it was probably around 12 or 15. There's a lot of wood everywhere in my monotonous, peaceful town, and not many houses or people. I was walking on this road near my house, which had a patch of forests on one side and a cornfield on the other. I had my convertible top down because it was about 75 degrees in the middle of summer. I could not identify which side of the road the loud, terrifying scream of a woman was coming from as I drove at about 50 miles per hour. I applied the brakes hard and listened as I quickly stopped the automobile. A woman's plea for assistance could be heard coming from the left side of the trees. I grabbed the baton from my rear seat as soon as I got out of my car. When I yelled out to anyone who was in the woods, the woman answered right away, pleading for assistance. I started to dash into the forest, clearing every branch and bush out of my path. I screamed at the woman to not stop screaming, so that I could locate her. She would cry out for help around every 10 seconds, and I would go toward her, yelling, but not until a short while. No matter how far into the woods I went, I began to realize. When I went, the woman's screams seemed to stay at the same distance rather than getting louder or closer, despite the fact that I was booking it directly towards the screens. I cried out, "Tell me where you are," and the woman cried out for aid again after approximately 5 seconds. At this point, I came to a standstill. This didn't sit well with me. I felt as though I was stepping into a trap. I spun around and began to run back towards my starting point. I didn't stop running until I saw my car's headlights blinking on the side of the road. I could still hear the woman screaming all the way back, beyond the trees. However, regardless of how near they were to my automobile, they remained at the same distance. I felt like she was stalking me and following me back. So I got in my car and sped out of there, very terrified out. I reported it to the authorities by calling 911 in case they wanted to look into it. Even though I was exhausted from informing a few friends and family about the unusual experience, I had no intention of staying there. A week later, I was prepared to move on with my life, until I saw something on the news that made me nauseous. A man walking his dog strangely in the woods discovered the lifeless body of a woman in her 30s. The body was supposed to have been located in the same general region where I heard the screaming, and that large section of wood showed no signs of foul play. That seems like such a strange coincidence. Can't help but think music. I was traveling to Vermont by car from Brooklyn to spend the weekend snowboarding. I'm going to my friend John's chalet. At the time of this incident, I was the driver of a 2006 Ford F-150 on this specific night, in addition to a 2013 BMW 3 Series. My snowboarding equipment was in the truck bed. It was late, maybe 10 o'clock at night, and I was still about 45 minutes away from my friend's cabin. These roadways were completely dark, and snow was falling. The route up there seemed to be devoid of any other vehicles. A few weeks prior, I had received my truck back from the repair. Thus, I was the only person there at that hour. That night, at arguably the worst conceivable hour on the quietest, darkest road, was no exception to the troubles I routinely had with that truck. My engine overheats to the point of the red zone, all of a sudden. I wait for it to cool down once again by slowing down and pulling over to the side. After that, I gradually resumed driving, but even at a leisurely pace, the engine was overheating as the needle returned to the red. I had to stop the truck and turn it off. I tried to diagnose the issue beneath the hood, but I was unable to. I had to phone John on this road in the dark and snow. There was no T-Mobile reception at all. I couldn't even make a help request. I got inside the truck to turn it on again and at least wait as soon as I felt screwed. It did not appear to overheat while idling in the truck's heat. I attempted to drive again, but the same issue persisted, so I had to wait for almost 10 minutes before noticing a passing car. I waved my arms, opened the door, and put on my hazards. The vehicle that was passing halted. It was a small Toyota. I thanked the man for stopping and asked to use his phone as he rolled down his window. Yes, tell me what transpired. I informed him that my truck was undrivable due to overheating. Then he inquired as to my loneliness. After pausing for a moment, I confirmed that he had indeed reached for and given me his cell phone. He had bars, so he must have been a local. When my friend John answered the phone, I asked him what I ought to do. He promised to come pick me up if I called this particular local towing firm. He stated he will head over once I gave him my precise location. I then provided the towing business his number to contact and asked for help on both calls. I tried not to glance back as the man in his car observed me the entire time. But after my phone conversations, I gave the man back his phone and thanked him. "Thank you for your hospitality," he added, rolling up his window and heading down the snowy road into the night. I was alone again, as I saw his taillights entirely vanish as he slid below the summit of the mountainous road above. I climbed back into my idling truck to enjoy the warmth. I turned off the headlights for a brief moment to gauge the darkness outside, and to my amazement, I was unable to see anything beyond the windows. I'm not making this up, it was utter darkness. I waited and waited while sitting in the truck. I was unable to perform any tasks that required an internet connection. I ended up using my phone to play games for 20 minutes until something hit my passenger side window with a boom. I gazed out the window and felt like I was jumping out of it. It was too dark to see anything of the individual, and the headlights barely illuminated the sides of the vehicle. A man's voice could be heard pleading with me to open the door and begging for assistance. I heard him attempting to unlock the door on his own, but it was locked, and he was shivering. I threw my flashlight against the window, but it didn't really help me see who was outside. What I observed was an individual wearing a large black coat with a hood covering his head. When I called back what was wrong, the enigmatic guy outside replied that he was lost, stranded, and in need of leaving the cold. I was scared as I tried to think of what to ask him to show that he wasn't someone who wanted to hurt me because I didn't trust him. Before I could even think of anything to say, he began angrily attempting to open the locked door and then began hammering even more forcefully against the glass while yelling for assistance in the heat of the moment. I chose to follow my instincts. When I shifted the truck into drive, he became aware of this and intensified his efforts to smash the window. Despite the damage, I got the truck on the road and increased its speed to 30 miles per hour. As I rounded the hill on the road, I was undoubtedly contributing to the overheated engine when I noticed something unexpected that made my heart skip a beat. As I drove past the parked automobile, I saw the reflection of oncoming taillights on the side of the road. I recognized that the man driving the Toyota was the same one from before. To check if the man was inside the car, I slowed down and rolled down the window. However, I saw nothing. It appeared that the automobile was empty. I glanced out the window briefly from behind. The man who was beating on my window was him, and he was attempting to fool me into opening the door by lighting up tracks in the snow with my taillights and the automobile. Who knows what happened, but I continued to drive my truck even though I knew I was up the engine, and I didn't care. A few minutes later, I noticed headlights approaching from the opposite direction. When I discovered it was the tow truck, I wanted to cheer with delight. I informed the driver of what had transpired when I flashed my lights, and he pulled to the side. He questioned if the man had a pistol or anything on him after making a joke about arriving at the appropriate moment. When I informed him that I was unable to see, he said, "Well, then we better get started right away." It took him about 15 minutes to attach the truck, and throughout that time, the Toyota never passed us. It was possible that this was the reason he turned around and headed in the opposite direction. I called John again using the tow truck driver's phone and told him to just come over. To sum up, the body shop fixed the damaged water pump in my truck, which was the reason for the overheating, John, and I continued to go snowboarding that weekend. A couple of weeks later, I sold the truck. In that situation, I'm grateful I refrained from lowering my window or opening my car's doors to the individual attempting to enter my vehicle. It would have remained a mystery who would have killed me if I had been slain. At 17, I got my first girlfriend. My parents had separated when I was 11 years old. Therefore, at the time, I was living with my mother. My girlfriend turned me down for a date one day because we both had jobs. She worked at a Starbucks, and I was employed at a nearby grocery shop. I invited her out on a date that day because it was a Friday, and we didn't have much homework to do after work. We were both day shift workers, and in our senior year of high school. That's it. I picked up my girlfriend from her place, and we headed to a little restaurant 10 minutes from my house. We had dinner at a time I could afford, and then we returned to her house to spend some time together before nightfall. She bemoaned the shortness of our date night, and I responded by telling her that I couldn't take her somewhere else without charging for it. We eventually came to an arrangement. We would take a drive at night. After leaving the town, we continued driving on an empty road through the woods until the pavement disappeared, and we were back on a dirt road. My girlfriend had to urinate as well, so I informed her how badly I needed to urinate. For some reason, as soon as we pulled over and got out of my car, we smelled something terrible and unfathomable. I explained that it was just another person pulling over to take care of business. When I told my girlfriend we would quickly urinate and then get back in the car to head back into town, she genuinely gagged at the scent. After we finished up, we headed back to my car across a small level space that served as the ideal location for pissing. However, while we were making our way back, we heard something that sounded like a scared twig snapping from the left side of us. We had to go back to my car since it was an animal. Before I could open my car door, my partner and I simply swore at someone, and I heard a scream of pain or dread. My girlfriend begged me not to, but I persuaded her to get in my car so I could look into it, just to feel safer for her. For some reason, I heard that scream again after I secured the doors and moved in our direction. Now that I had damaged him much more, I had lost all bravery to look into it. But when I heard it, it seemed like it was coming from the same direction as my girlfriend's, and I had heard the twig snapping in rather than heading that way. I picked up my phone, snapped a photo after turning on the flash and letting it go off. A man with black stripes on a white shirt and a blue tarp directly in front of him caught my attention. I sprinted to the car as soon as I saw him standing there. When I got in my car, put it in drive, and floored it, my girlfriend started asking me what had occurred since she could tell I was afraid. After we returned to the less savory part of town, I promised her I would explain. After that, I drove back to my girlfriend's place. When we got there, I informed her I had seen the man standing there alone in front of him with a blue tarp. We were both really spooked by the picture, and since it was a Friday, and we didn't have work or school the following day, I was allowed to stay the night. That was the scariest thing I have ever seen in my life. We are no longer together. I am 23, and she is 22, but we remain best friends. It was the end of July, 2011. My best friend, who was a few years younger than me, and I were hanging out when I was around 19 years old. About 15 minutes away from Mount Airy, North Carolina, is where we reside in a very remote part of Southwest Virginia. Almost everything closes by 10 p.m. around here. You must therefore find your own ways to kill time. But that was never an issue for us, because we could always find something enjoyable to do. The evening began innocuously enough. When it didn't work, he went to the mall first, then cruised the streets seeking for girls, doing whatever teenage boys would do. We simply made the decision to go bowling till they closed. Then, just before midnight, we headed to Main Street to explore some of the back alleys while behaving like edgy badasses. We believed we were, but because there isn't a lot of violent crime in the region, we never felt in danger. We decided to grab a bite at Waffle House after walking all the streets because, at the time, it was the only late-night dining choice available. We were bored with walking around. We weren't ready to head home, even after we finished our meal and made a brief detour at Walmart. We decided to drive around some of the backcountry roads, which was nothing new for us because, as I've mentioned before, you had to manufacture your own entertainment here. We also always liked taking late-night drives on this particular stretch of road. We were now traveling. I think I had only ever driven during the day once, despite the fact that neither of us lived far from it. The road is paved for about a mile before entering Virginia again and turning into dirt, exactly like most of the dirt roads in the area. The county doesn't really pay much attention to this one, so we didn't see any reason to drive down it while we were still in Carolina, because very few residences are on it, and it's quite remote. We were both becoming more cautious now that we were both driving at a crawl, because the road washes away frequently during severe rains, which requires you to drive considerably more slowly. With just a few houses along this road, we were confident we wouldn't encounter any other vehicles, even though it still felt like any other route we would drive at this time of night. At night, the road lies at the base of a small mountain and is mostly covered in woods. It's simple to miss any of the residences on it. Chances are, we would have overlooked them all. Had it not been for the flickering light in the corner of our eyes, we both would have noticed a man standing beneath his porch light. The man's features were visible to us, and despite his head following us, we could tell he was staring at us while remaining perfectly still. Even though we were both on edge right now, we tried not to worry about it, because we assumed it was just someone going outside to smoke. We found his manner extremely uncomfortable, and nothing seemed to change for the man who was observing us. This was just the beginning. As we talked more about it, and were a little more uneasy, we progressively accelerated our pace. But in a matter of minutes, we reached the end of the road and returned to the hardtop, which I drove around once a week and was much more comfortable with. He made a right turn, and we felt a lot better because we could now move faster and put that man's thoughts behind us. After a few miles, the road climbs up onto a small mountain ridge and provides breathtaking views of the town below. We appreciated the scenery from this road. After coming to an end of this road, we turned right again to head back to my house. Compared to that route, this one has a little more woods. I had driven or rode this road before, so even though we had just turned, I knew it even better. The things we've seen in the far distance of our headlights as we've been heading back toward the main highway literally dozens of times before have been terrible around here. We assumed that was all it was, and when we decelerated, we saw that it was significantly wider than a deer's brown fur. But since we're both accustomed to occasionally seeing albinos, we continued to believe that was all it was. However, as we drew nearer, we saw it wasn't an animal at all. Rather, it was a human, who was slumped down with their back to us. As one should, they were walking against traffic in the left lane. My friend said, "What the hell are they doing walking at this time of night?" When I turned to face the person again, I was able to finally make out the outline of an older-looking woman with long gray hair that was unkempt and dressed in white jeans and a white t-shirt. Until we were about 50 feet away from her, she continued to face away from us. She turned to face us at that point, giving us our first glimpse of her face. She gave off the appearance of having deep eye sockets with heavy, dark bags under them, greasy hair, and really elderly skin. I'm not sure how old she was. In fact, between the ages of 40 and 50, if I had to guess, but that wasn't the worst of it. She raised her hands in the air, began wildly waving them, and hurried in our direction. When she finally did, we noticed what appeared to be dried blood everywhere. The front of her jeans and shirt, and in one hand she appeared to be holding a large knife. We had no idea what she wanted, but she quickly lost interest in wanting to be edgy badasses. We didn't let up until we got to the interstate, so we really floored it. We were so scared of the whole thing that a quick 5-minute journey to my house turned into a 35-minute diversion because of our ridiculous belief that she may follow us. In small towns like these, you get to know most people, yet neither of us had ever seen this woman before. We never heard anything about the bloody woman being hauled up, even though we continued to keep an eye on the local news. With all the possibilities of human or animal altercations, I cannot even begin to imagine why she would be traveling the backcountry roads at nearly 4 in the morning in her shape, with blood on her clothes and a knife in her hand. Let's go back to the current day. I now take the latter road practically daily and reside with my wife on that quiet road on the mountain ridge between the two roads of the occurrences. Since a large drug and cockfighting ring was busted down the man's street earlier this year, I have still not seen the strange woman. After everything that transpired, I frequently wondered if that was the same house where these individuals were living in the neighborhood back then. I'm not sure if that was the same house. I simply hope I never run into that woman again. Perhaps that guy was just keeping watch over the property.